it's disconcerting to people like me who have been here for a long time. And yes, I do say people like me. And for those of you who have heard the long tapes that I recorded, you'll understand what I mean when I say that. For those of you that haven't, let me clarify. I've lived on your planet for 3,500 years. I'm not human, but I very much consider myself one of you. I care deeply about a great many of you. I have so many friends, and I've had so many friends. And I use that term very conservatively. It's very rare that I call an individual, a human, my friend. And I have had many. And that's saying something about you as a species. There are a great many of you out there who, when I talk to you, say, what am I supposed to do? How am I supposed to convince people of what's coming and what to prepare for? So I'll tell you now what I tell everyone else. You can't convince them. If you knew a biblical flood was coming, and you were going to make everyone you knew by a boat, how would you do that? If you knew for a fact a great flood was coming, and the only thing you needed to have to survive it was a small dinghy, what would you do to convince everyone you know to get that dinghy? You'd probably make something up. You would probably beg. You would probably, if you were in a position to purchase said small craft for your loved ones, it would drive you mad that they didn't take you seriously, wouldn't it? Well, many of you have these similar type feelings about what's coming in your time in the year 2012. There will be, over the next few years, great upheavals on your planet, both within your culture and within your planet itself. The oceans will move. The earth will move. Earthquakes that were once thought to be 100-year earthquakes will become 10-year earthquakes. Storms that were thought to occur maybe once in a century will then be said to occur once per decade. As science and as this conventional wisdom around you begins to adapt to what's happening, people will have their own ways of dealing with the new reality of what your planet will experience. People who listen to me, I believe, will have a leg up on those around them, simply because they know that there are species right here in your own quadrant of this galaxy who wish to help you. I am one of them. My planet, Ibania, is not near here. My planet is near the center of what you would call the Milky Way galaxy, but on the other side of where Delta Sol is. I know that I wish to help you, and that a female being from my planet, whom I call Tifi, wishes to help you. And she is out among you right now, in a very high-profile position. Think about your world leaders right now. Think about a very beautiful, very powerful, well, potentially powerful woman. Over the next 2 years, you'll know exactly who I'm talking about. There's no mistaking Tifi, but we wish to help you. And our message is simple. It's you have to come together as an entire population on this planet. You have been given the gift of what you call the internet. Regardless of who gave you that gift or how that technology came about, it does exist now, and it has changed your planet for the better. Because people all around the world now can communicate these new ideas, these new frontiers of thinking. And as these dreams that you're all starting to experience, or at least many of you that I speak with are beginning to experience, that some of you refer to as intense, some of you refer to as would the word be confusing or befuddling? It leaves you, when you wake up, many people tell me they wake up and they feel as if they've seen a bunch of something whiz by them at a very high rate of speed, and they haven't been able to catch quite what it was, and it's an uncomfortable feeling. What's that? Oh, it's time for lunch. My heavens, lunch on a boat. I spend a lot of time traversing the seas, and I always find it odd that there are some fishermen who wouldn't eat a fish. They'd bite off one of their own toes and chew on it before they'd eat a fish. They're so sick of looking at them. And then there are others who the sea is just a giant smorgasbord to these people, and I am on a boat with the latter. We have eaten fish now for about a week, and I can taste toxins in your fish. Very interesting to the individuals that I'm with right now, the difference in the amount and the variety of fish they say is changing around the globe. Seafaring folks speak with me about this all the time. Places that they typically were able to catch a certain type of fish, now they either catch something different or none at all. And they have been successful in some extent fishing in areas now that before seemed devoid of life. Your oceans are changing dramatically on this planet, even as we speak. This year, it's been made evident, it's been made very clear in both the southern hemisphere, in Australia. I've seen the beginnings of great flooding there. And I think that as 2011 begins, Australia is going to experience more large-scale flooding. It's a very old continent, Australia, but there's a lot of sand that can wash away in certain places. I'm not saying that to be disrespectful. I love Australia. I've spent a lot of time there. But you look around that country, that continent of Australia, and everywhere, long-forgotten change is visibly evident everywhere you go. The landscape itself is such stark contrasts everywhere. The rocks, the colors. It's almost as if a great rake went through the land and tore bits of it up. In the north, right now, in December 2010 and going into early 2011 in Europe, devastating cold. The individuals that I know in Russia that I keep in contact with have told me it's colder this year than it has been at any time they can remember. And it gets very cold in Russia. And this is coming from a being who is cold everywhere on your planet. I really like to try to keep myself at a place on your planet that is above 90 degrees at all times. 90 degrees Fahrenheit, of course. I find I am most comfortable in very hot, dry climates. And I think that as I head down south into, it's certainly warmer here than it's going to be come winter, but it's still very, very cold to me. But I approach these islands, and it makes me think of all the history and culture that's contained underneath these waters that your planet knows nothing about, and all of the other places on your planet, great societies that have existed throughout time, that the current modern age chooses to, for a great part, be oblivious to or ignorant of. And a lot of that is due to history that is taught throughout your planet right now is, for the most part, false. The history books or the history instruction that you received, whether at university or as a youth in primary school, is very much, for the most part, false. And then there are countries that I've visited, like North Korea, where the history is so completely preposterous that you wonder how anyone in their right mind could possibly believe such nonsense. Yet they do. Every variation of culture that exists right now on this planet has their own version of your history. And my intent is to pull back this veil that's been put between you and your rightful past. It's your genealogy that I speak of here, not mine. You deserve to know this. Now, in America, when the New World was quote-unquote discovered, around the end of the 15th century, opened up a lot of trade or possibilities for trade for individuals that then resided in Europe. Many of these individuals were descended from those who had existed on Lemuria before it was the sea, swelled up and overtook it. Now, these individuals went to Europe and lived there quite comfortably because they had already had pre-established routes of trade. Many of them were away, so to speak, when this disaster befell that island nation. These individuals, when they found out about this new world, what now is referred to as the West or North and South America, as the continents go, already knew the best trade routes around the globe. They were very quick to use their resources to jump in at this opportunity and establish what came to be called the East India Trading Company. And they very much needed new ground from which to operate. And America became that new ground. These individuals were guests in someone else's kingdom in Europe, in the old world. They needed a place they could create on their own. And they established parties to come to North America, to what's now the eastern coast of the United States, long before the ones that in America they refer to as the Pilgrims came to that place in their state of Massachusetts, that the Rock of Plymouth. There were already individuals from Europe there at the time. But history was written because they wanted it told that this group of pious, religious freedom seekers had set out across the waves and established this colony at, I believe in America they call it Jamestown, and grew from there. When in reality, the actual history is, this was a very calculated birth of a nation. And the United States of America right now is losing its grip on world power. As I record this at the end of 2010, going into 2011, China will begin to flex its economic muscle around the globe. But I'm going to flip this tape over, as I think it's going to end, and I'm going to tell you the true history of the United States of America.